So Leslie Kim, thanks for being with us today for this international symposium. It's a great honor. I will present you for our public. You are an independent investigative journalist focused on bringing credible information about hidden, paranormal, and impossible realities into the mainstream. You founded in 2002 the Coalition for Freedom of Information, an independent alliance to open up information on UFOs. You are the author of the award-winning book, Sons of Surviving Death, A Journalist Investigates Evidence for an Afterlife, and UFO Generals, Pilots, and Government Officials Go on the Record. It was a 2010 New York Times bestseller and has been published in 8 additional languages. Today, I will be accompanied by Jocelyn Morisson. Jocelyn Morisson is a science journalist and author. So Leslie King, our first question, please. How did you get involved with UFOs and have you had a personal experience?
I really haven't had a personal experience that I have any clarity about. So, I first got involved in 1999 when I received the French Cometa report, which I won't explain because I'm assuming everybody knows what that is, especially since this is a French conference. But I received an English translation of the Cometa report in the mail in 1999. And I was working at a radio station at the time as a journalist. So I was absolutely stunned by the power of that report and by the conclusions that the very distinguished authors made, which was that the extraterrestrial hypothesis was the most valid, logical, and rational explanation for these official cases that they studied. And they studied official cases with a lot of data. So they had enough data to determine that they couldn't be explained through conventional means, the cases they studied. And I thought as a journalist, this was a really big story because these were very high level military people in France. So I wrote a story, I published a piece in the Boston Globe because I was doing a lot of freelance reporting then about this Cometa report, and did some other research for the story. And it was a long story, very serious. And in those days, no journalists were writing serious stories about UFOs in the mainstream. So it was a big breakthrough and everybody was very happy about it. So after that, I was so involved, so interested and so passionately, interested in this topic that I wanted to just do nothing else. And that's how it all started.
So I'm asking questions on behalf of our good friend, Fabrice Bonvin, who is a ufologist. You were part of the team who revealed the existence of the AATIP program in the 2017 New York Times articles. How did you convince the editors to publish a UAP story in the front page of the New York Times? What was the process? Was it difficult?
Yeah, that's a really good question. What happened was, the first thing that happened was I was called into a meeting with Luis Elizondo, who was the head of this AATIP program, and he was about to resign. It was literally the day that he was going to resign. It was October 4th, 2017. And there were three other high-level officials, high-level people there that were associated with him and with the program that invited me to this meeting. And I was shown everything about the program. I was shown the three videos that are now famous, documents that showed Harry Reid's support and involvement for the program, Luis Elizondo's resignation letter for the Secretary of Defense, his performance evaluations, and lots of other information. And I spent about 3 hours talking to him. And so after that, I realized this really was the kind of story that the New York Times would be interested in because we had so many sources on the record. This was a Defense Department story and huge that they had been studying UFOs all these years and nobody knew about it. And obviously, if they were studying them, it meant there was something real there because they weren't going to be wasting their time and money otherwise. So that was a big deal. So I contacted my colleague, Ralph Blumenthal, who is a freelancer for the Times, because I had no relationship to the New York Times at that point. And we sat down and looked at all the information, and he emailed an editor at the Times that he knew. And we had a meeting with Mark Mazzetti, who was the investigations editor in the Washington Bureau. And at this point, we still didn't really know, but we really felt we had something important. And we showed Mark Mazzetti all the data, all the online, you know, all the sources who were going on the record. That was so important. The videos, the documents, and he took everything back to Washington. And about a week later, we heard from the head of the Washington Bureau that she wanted to go ahead with the story. And she assigned Helene Cooper, an outstanding Pentagon reporter, to work with us. So to answer the question, was it hard? I mean, you know, it's interesting. I don't think it was that difficult to get the Times interested in this because it was such an explosive story, because we had everybody on the record. We had Harry Reid, senator who had funded the program, and we had Mr. Elizondo, the head of the program. We had other people who were associates of the program, including Robert Bigelow. I think if we hadn't had Harry Reid, they might not have accepted it. But Helene Cooper flew to Las Vegas, interviewed him in person. It was the first time that he had talked about this program. And the other thing was, to go along with it, we had the story of the Nimitz case, the very famous 2004 case. We were able to interview Dave Fravor. This was the first time he had become known. He's now like world famous, you know, and some other people from that case. And we did, part of our story covered that case. So I really wasn't surprised, to tell you the truth, that the Times was interested in it. I mean, how could you not be? We had everything. And just to add that in terms of the front page, we had no say in where the story was going to be placed. So it was up to the editors. We were hoping, and we got word that it would be on the front page, let's put it that way, but it wasn't up to us, of course. And the headline was also not ours. So the Times has its own staffer that does nothing but writes headlines. So the headline in the print version was different than the one on the online version. So there were two different headlines. But that's how it all happened. We spent a couple of months working on writing the story. It was very difficult in that there was a lot of editing. I mean, the Times is not an easy place to write for. They're very, very rigorous in their vetting of everything. And there were things we would have liked to have included that we were not able to include, partly because of space, partly because of what our editors felt. So it was quite an arduous process, but it was well worth it. And it was like a turning point in my career.
Right. That's what I was about to say. A turning point started a lot of things. So I wanted to ask as well, on behalf of Fabrice, in your opinion, is there a disclosure plan? And as a bonus question, are you part of it, willingly or not? And if yes, is there an international agenda to accelerate the disclosure process?
I mean, I'm not sure quite what, it depends what he means by a disclosure plan. I mean, I don't think there are
Getting the public to know about the truth.
Right. But at what level the planning is taking place? I mean, it's not like there's, I don't think, a few guys in some back room orchestrating everything and everybody's just kind of puppets. You know, I don't think it happens that way. But I would say there is a plan in that the Congress in the United States is very active in trying to facilitate disclosure. And they've had their first congressional hearing last May. Plus, they have passed legislation, or it hasn't passed yet, but I suspect it will, to protect whistleblowers who want to come forward, so that next year we will probably see some very interesting testimony from people on the inside who are going to be safe coming forward to Congress and hopefully to the public. So in that sense, I mean, there's a plan, and that Congress wants it to happen. They're moving in gradual steps to do whatever they can. I think that some of the military people in the military, some of them may not agree that it should happen at all. Others feel it should happen very slowly. Others might want it to happen faster. I think there's a lot of different groups that feel differently about this. But I think as long as legislation is being passed by the Congress, which requires certain things to happen, they're going to happen. So I think we're going to see in 2023 or 2024, we're going to see some significant things happen, which may finally be the disclosure that everybody's been looking for. In terms of the international scene, I mean, I really don't know. I can't speak to that. I think there's competition, certainly between, according to what the military people tell me, between Russia and America and China probably too, who have their own programs and probably have their own materials that they're studying. And the interest in the military is in the technology. So these countries all want to be the first to get that technology, to understand how it works, and then maybe someday to be able to manufacture it. I think it'll be a long time before we can do that, but they all want to understand how it works. So these countries are very protective of their own information so that their adversaries don't get a hold of it. So I'm not sure there's much cooperation on an international level, except with our allies, of course, but the Russia and China are sort of the big elements that, you know, our government is concerned about.
So another question, please. What will be your advice to the UFO community?
I think the UFO community has done some tremendous work, and at least in America, they're doing, and you have GEPAN in France, and you have, I think, more government. I mean, you've had the government involved since the 70s, right? So I can't tell anybody in France really any advice, but I would say that our community of you know, independent researchers and civilian investigators have done a tremendous job since the close of Project Blue Book. If these people had not been doing this work, we would have nothing today. I mean, they have carried the torch, and they still are doing tremendous work. And I would just encourage our community to not engage in a lot of conspiracy theories or ideas about, you know, reptilians coming from the Pleiades, or kind of the fringe ideas that actually slow the progress, because you don't want the officials to feel like this is something they can't engage with. So for the government to be able to engage with it, which is what everybody wants, we have to be very careful to only put out very solid information and evidence that's really, that we can back up, and that is not sensationalistic or conspiratorial or kind of fantasy prone. So I think that's the only, I mean, I think everybody's doing a great job. There is a lot of infighting among the community in America, which is unfortunate. But I think overall, people understand. I think in 2017, everybody got more serious. And a lot of people in the UFO community kind of realized the seriousness of what we're dealing with. And they realized that we really are on the way right now. So they've been very good at contributing and doing good work. So, I mean, I'm not in a position to give anybody advice. I just want it to stay at a very high level, so that our government officials are not kind of turned off by and feel like there's still a taboo. We need to overcome the stigma. And the way to overcome the stigma is to only talk about very, very serious and you know, solid information. And the other thing that needs to happen is our scientists need to get involved. The scientists are more impacted by the taboo than the government is, and in America. And so in order for scientists to feel that they can bring this up within their universities, that taboo has to come down. And so the UFO community needs to be careful not to exacerbate that taboo by putting out information that's kind of silly or, you know, conspiratorial. That would be my only advice, really.
All right. So in the States, currently the UAP issue is kind of championed by leading politicians such as Senators Marco Rubio or Kirsten Gillibrand. Do you think that the UAP issue will play an important part in the next elections, the midterm and presidential?
I don't think it will play a huge part. I mean, it's very important to some people, but I think we lose perspective. Those of us who are involved, to us, it is like the biggest thing there is. Most important issue. That's how I feel. But we forget that the vast majority of people in America don't know anything about it and don't care about it. So what happens with the elections is, if there's an open forum, like a town hall or something, then some American citizen might be able to ask a question of a politician that'll end up on TV or something. But I can't imagine that it'll go beyond that, certainly not in the midterms that are coming up. I don't know about the presidential election, because a lot is going to happen in the next 2 years. And so it may be an issue for the next presidential election. But I think the ones that we have coming up in November, it's not going to be a big issue. Unless somebody can throw a question in, like I said, when there's a camera running at a gathering with somebody. That's about as far as I think it will go.
All right. So about Lou Elizondo, after surfing on an image of a whistleblower, he sees his image somewhat damaged by contradictions noted by some researchers in the field, Stephen Greenstreet, John Greenwald. On his role within the AAT program, what do you think about this?
I don't support that position. I have known from the very beginning in October, when I was shown lots of documents and when I met Mr. Elizondo, that there is no question he played the role in ATIP that he says he played. It was a very small organization. It didn't have funding in the later years, but nonetheless, it did keep going. And I have spoken to many other people who worked with the ATIP program, who vouched for the role that Lou played. And Harry Reid is one of those people, but many others. So in my mind, there's no question he was the key person involved with the ATIP program. And I don't understand. I have great respect for Lou. He has absolutely brought about a transformation in our world. He and Chris Mellon are the key people who have brought about the changes that have happened. And to sit around and argue about whether he was or wasn't ATIP and try to criticize him, I feel like is disrespectful. And I don't want to be part of that. I don't really pay attention to it, to be honest. But I have seen enough documentation myself, much of it, which I have not made public, including emails and from the ATIP program and interviews with people involved, that I know for a fact that Lou was, running that program. So I'm not concerned about it. And I'm just sorry that there's been so much discourse about that.
All right. I read that there was a regulation that was passed in November 2021, law that said that the U.S. Army was about to establish an office, permanent office, to study the UFO phenomenon. Has this happened yet, or is this still in progress?
Yeah, I think, I don't know about the U.S. Army. I think you maybe mean the Department of Defense, correct?
Yes, probably.
Yeah. Yes, so there has been an agency set up within the Department of Defense.
Right.
And it was mandated by law. And they're supposed to provide reports to the public. Mm-hmm. And two people associated with that were testified in before Congress, a congressional committee, let's say, last May. So I don't know how many people in France saw that hearing, but it's all available to watch. It was very interesting. I was actually present in the room. And so this agency exists. I think there's some concern that it needs to be doing more, but basically what it's doing now is trying to gather all the data that has been dispersed through all these different places within the US government. I mean, it's all over the place, and you don't even know what this agency has over here and this one over here has stuff, and they have to approach all these different agencies and get them to release their data and then get it centralized in one database, get it organized. And that's a big process because there are so many different intelligence agencies and space agencies and that in the US, that have this information. So right now that's been their major focus, is gathering the data. Then, I think that they keep changing the name. It's going to have a new name again. And I think the Congress is really trying to push on this agency to be as efficient as they possibly can. But they have a lot to do since this is something brand new. We haven't had anything like this before. So they really have their hands full with just trying to pull together what we already have and also looking at new events that happen. But they're fairly quiet. We don't hear much in the press about what they're actually doing, other than just trying to get themselves up and rolling. But it's a major development that this we have this agency at all.
So the agency doesn't have a name yet?
It has had like two or three different names.
Okay.
And the one, and it keeps getting different names and acronyms that are very hard to say.
All right.
The last one, so people tend to just recall it maybe the UAP Task Force. Or something like that, just to make it easy. But I know that they're going to give it a new name soon, which will probably be the final name. But it's definitely happening. It's just a slow process.
Do you think that they will take inspiration from the French GEPAN structure?
I would hope so. And I would hope that they will interact with GEPAN. I mean, I know that, there are some Americans like Jacques Vallée and others. I mean, he's not American, but he lives in America, that have connections with GEPAN. And I hope that I think it's just too early for this agency to start doing that. But I think once they're up and running, it's extremely important to me that they interact with GEPAN and other countries that have agencies like countries in South America that are interested in this. So hopefully your next conference, they will participate. You can invite them. I hope so.
Thank you, Marie-France.
Yes, yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Leslie. So I have got two other questions. First, which was the case you prefer and that you have studied?
Which case do I prefer? Of what?
Which was the case you prefer? Just that you prefer.
Oh my gosh, that's a hard one.
Very difficult question.
Oh, so many great. There's so many great cases. So much important data and evidence for this phenomenon. I mean, I think it almost now, of course, nobody questions that it's real, thankfully. But certainly the Nimitz case of 2004. I think a lot of there's a lot of focus on that in America. I think some officials feel it's one of the best cases we've ever had in terms of the amount of evidence, we got the radar and all the visual sightings and the video and so many people involved and this phenomenal object that was flying around over the water. I mean, there are cases from the 70s. There are cases in France, of course, the landing case, which you all know very well, where the traces were left on the ground, the farmer, I just forget the name of it at this moment. The Jacques Vallée investigated that case too, and the GEPAN did as well. I think you know the case I mean. I mean, there was the 1986 case over Alaska in America, where the pilots, there were three crew that saw this gigantic walnut-shaped UFO, the Rendlesham Forest. I mean, so many wonderful cases. And I think what I did in my book in 2010 was I put in that book the cases that I thought were the most convincing. So and then one of them also is the case at O'Hare Airport in America in 2006, which I wrote about in my book. And then the Channel Islands in 2007, which of course was right off the coast of France, involving a pilot from Origny Airlines who saw these gigantic, huge two UFOs sitting there, and his passengers saw them too. So I don't know, I could go on and on and on. But I think since 2010, certainly the Nimitz case is the one that stands out. And then there's all the sightings off the coast of the eastern United States by Navy pilots that we wrote about in our other New York Times story in 2019, which is where Ryan Graves, the young pilot from the Navy, came forward. And he has since become very well known in America. And he talked about the almost daily sightings that these pilots have. And it's still happening, of these small, very fast objects. And we still don't know what they are.
Thanks, Leslie. Another question, please. You are interested in consciousness studies such as NDE. So how do you consider the link between UAP and consciousness?
That is the big question. That's such a great question because it's really the cutting edge question right now, at least in America, that the people who, the thinkers and the academics and the intellectuals and the investigators are all very interested in finding the connection between consciousness and UFOs, and maybe even between the afterlife, if there is one, which is what I wrote about in my book, Surviving Death. But when I wrote that book, I was thinking of it as something completely separate from UFOs, no connection at all. I have since come to learn, and that was in 2017 when that book came out, I have since come to learn that there is a connection between consciousness and UFOs. And, you know, I can't say exactly, I don't think anybody has really nailed down what that is, but there are psychological and spiritual and psychic effects that happen to people who see them. So people's consciousness is affected by an encounter with a UFO. Some people will have psychic abilities develop after they see a UFO, which they didn't have before. So they might develop abilities for precognition or clairvoyance or telepathy. They just have a certain perception that's opened up by having had the encounter with the UFOs. The other thing there's been a lot of research done on in America is that there are these sort of what we might call poltergeist type activity that goes on in connection with UFOs. And one of the places this was studied was the Skinwalker Ranch in Utah, but it's happened in other places where there's a UFO, but then there's also all this other activity that seems to be associated with it that is more consciousness related, like just other kinds of anomalies that happen. And people have health impacts and psychological impacts. And another example of thing, you know, these are just sort of random examples that I can think of where consciousness is involved. Sometimes you have a sighting, a multiple witness sighting, where people will see different things. They'll all be looking at the same UFO, but they will perceive it differently. Or some won't see it at all, which shows that the consciousness of the people observing it is playing a role in how it is being perceived. It's not just, there's something else going on that's not just this objective three-dimensional object, but their minds are affected by it. And so, you know, if one thinks that consciousness is really a fundamental aspect of reality rather than physical matter, and that perhaps our brains are more like antenna, it's all about how you see reality and how you understand consciousness. But UFOs are definitely something more than just a three-dimensional physical object flying around. It's something more than technology. And what that something more is about consciousness, is about the mind of the observer and how it impacts the mind. And even deceased people will show up sometimes in events that involve UFOs. People will see a deceased relative connected with a UFO, or people that have a near-death experience will see what they think is an alien or an extraterrestrial type creature. So it's all mixed up. The other thing just finally to mention is the hitchhiker effect, where people will encounter a UFO with other strange phenomena associated with it. And then they go away and the phenomena seems to follow them into their homes. And they continue to have strange poltergeist type events happening in their homes after seeing the UFO. Something goes with them. So it's all very mysterious, but it's obviously something much more complicated than a physical craft in the sky. And you know, of course, Jacques Vallée has been talking about this for decades, that there's no simple explanation for this phenomenon, and that it's much bigger than something physical, and that it does impact people, and people's consciousness interact with it in ways we still don't understand. But that's what we need to do more research on. I think that's really the current question right now, that a lot of people are focused on is how to make that connection between consciousness and UFOs. And what does it mean? What is that connection? What is the UFO is basically what it boils down to. And it's so complicated that we may never really understand it, but we're all trying to understand as best we can.
Yes, thanks, Leslie. Another question, please. What is your opinion about the ranch, the Skywalker ranch, on what happened?
Yeah, I mean, that's what I was just referencing. The Skinwalker Ranch in Utah is a sort of a what they call a hotspot, or there's some kind of connection there to some other dimension. And there have been scientists studying it for a long time. It's one of the most highly studied places where phenomena occur and that have been studied. Now, there are other places on the planet where a lot of phenomena occur. But this one is probably the most well-studied, the most well-documented, and there have been physicists and other scientists going out there for a long time. And so I highly respect, I mean, what do I think about it? I think it's absolutely fascinating. I think it's creepy. I wouldn't want to go there myself because, like I was saying, there's this hitchhiker effect where if you go there and you experience something, it follows you into your home. And this is one of the things that's been happening at the Skinwalker Ranch. So it's been an amazing laboratory for the study of these very strange phenomena that are not just about UFOs, but about all kinds of other things like mutilated animals and portals with creatures coming out of it, all kinds of strange things, poltergeistian type effects. So I would encourage everyone to read the book called Skinwalkers at the Pentagon, which just came out a few years ago. It's very, very interesting. And this work was funded by the Defense Intelligence Agency in the United States. It was the precursor to the ATIP program. So there were 2 years of work done on this ranch, which were funded by the American government. So it's definitely information very, very well worth looking at, I think.
Yes, thanks for being with us for this international symposium, and hope to talk to you soon.
Okay, thank you so much.
Have a great nice day.
Bye.
Yeah. Okay, bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.